Well, boys, looks like you started the fun without me.
You're all sick. Every last one of you.
We're going to need a bigger gun.
What's the matter? You scared of things that go boom?
Give me one goddamn reason why I shouldn't blow your goddamn brains all over that goddamn wall.
My name is Eric, and with me today is my reluctant co-host, Michael. Let's just, you know what, we just need to move right into films today. So we saw two films.
And we're going to spoil them.
Okay. What are those films?
2001 Maniacs.
Uh-huh.
And Flock of Dodos.
All right. So if you haven't seen those films, see the films, because we're going to talk about them. Why are you listening to this if you haven't seen the film? That doesn't make any sense.
Who are you, by the way?
Yeah,
send us a postcard. Let us know your name.
Yeah.
A little bit about yourself and where you hang out.
And then we'll not talk about you on the podcast.
Nope.
So the first film, 2001 Maniacs, not 2001 Maniacs.
Not 2001. Were you under the impression that it was 2001 Maniacs?
No, but I saw 2001.
Okay.
And I was like, oh, this will give me a good example to tell people how to correctly pronounce the year, because for the last 8 years, people have had trouble doing that.
Okay.
But no, 2001 is 2001 how
Maniacs.
Many Maniacs there are.
That's exactly right. So 2001 Maniacs is a film. It's directed by, first-time director Tim Sullivan.
Right.
Who plays Coffin Harry in the film. And more importantly than the director, for the first time ever in the podcast, produced by Eli Roth.
Right. Who is not one of the 2001 Maniacs.
One of the 2001 Maniacs. So a little bit about this whole Eli Roth thing, which I just love about the film. First off, Eli Roth, we've already watched all three of his other films. We watched...
If this isn't obvious, so I don't even say this anymore because it should be obvious, but this was a film you own that I saw.
Yeah, right.
If there's people being like beaten, bludgeoned, or ripped apart, it's your film. And if it's a documentary about intelligent design, it's my film.
Right, exactly. That's how that works.
All right.
So Eli Roth, who we watched Cabin Fever, Hostel, and Hostel 2.
Right.
And I'm pretty sure you're slowly getting into Eli Roth, although you're not 100% convinced he's a genius.
I'm going to cling on to my skepticism as long as possible.
All right.
But also Thanksgiving. Come on.
Right. Well, I'm going to go ahead and say that this is just another point for Eli Roth as genius, although he just produced. but he plays a role in this film.
Mm-hmm.
He reprises his Cabin Fever role as Grimm, complete with Dr. Mambo.
Yeah, right.
And
we're slowly starting to understand the mythology of Grimm.
Of Grimm.
Not Dr. Mambo yet. No. We'll get there. But
so the thing that I really like about this is that in Cabin Fever, there's that strange, like oddly ambiguous, but you accept it because he's a burnout.
Right.
Where he goes faced. Yeah. He like, you know, scratches down his face with his hand when he burns them.
Which
or, you know,
I'm sure is
ever.
Like an Eli Roth inside joke he decided to put in.
And
in the film.
In this film, they tell you where it came from.
Right.
It comes from these guys who almost pick him up, but then don't. And another thing I want to touch on that just real quick with Eli Roth is that in a deleted scene, Grimm has a line where they're like, we're going down to Daytona Beach. And he's like, oh, sorry, dudes, I'm headed up north, you know, cabins and shit.
Nice.
To let you know that on the timeline of Cabin Fever versus 2001 Maniacs, that this is actually a precursor to the story of Cabin Fever.
I was kind of kidding when I said mythology, but this is kind of heavy Eli Roth mythology. Yep. How cool would it be if he just starts popping up everywhere?
I would be totally okay with that.
It's possible that that already happened and we're just not aware of it, right?
Yeah.
I mean, this is kind of a lesser known film. Where did you find this?
Dude, it took me IMDb search for Robert Englund and then produced by Eli Roth and I was in.
You were done?
Yeah.
You're
I was
must find
right
this
in
film.
There.
So I have to mention just briefly, they have almost right after that scene, they have a scare shot from the trunk. It's notable just because it was probably one of the most well-executed ones I've seen yet.
Yeah.
And really one of the only ones in the film. There's kind of little,
there's
like
a few
mandatory ones in a film like this. But God, that one got me. And usually I can see them coming and they still get me.
Yeah.
You know, that's the nature of that kind of shot is like, it's more about like biology than art at that point. But man, that one, I didn't even see it coming. I fell off the couch. It was awful.
Travis Tritt just fucking jumps out of the trunk and beats him with a crowbar.
Yeah, it's great. And then you get the bludgeoning with the crowbar, which is wonderful. Bludgeoning is my new favorite word,
bludgeoning.
In case you didn't notice that.
Twice already. So
I want to talk a little bit when we get into this. So I thought this would be, as you've said many a time before, a candy sort of podcast. Yeah. And for me, there's a lot more to this film.
Oh, which, there is. Which is strange.
Right, I'm glad that's, yeah.
It, okay. Because it like totally doesn't seem like it. And I'm going to actually backtrack because I think I know what you're going to get into here. Uh-huh. I'm going to backtrack to the beginning of the film because this is something I also wanted to mention. And we can touch on it more when we get into the cast. But Peter Stormare.
Yeah.
Cameos in the, not really a cameo. He has a bit part.
Yeah.
In the beginning of the film as the history teacher.
Right.
And as a history teacher, like, he gives all the, like, you know, standard history teacher, right. You know, those who ignore history are doomed to repeat it.
Right.
All those like standard lines. But like watching the film and thinking about those lines, you're like, yeah, you know, this is just an instance of kids that weren't paying attention in history class. Yeah, that would have known exactly how to handle a situation. Mm-hmm. And then furthermore, it just goes on to illustrate that these people are stuck way back in, you know, 150 years ago, Civil War time.
Yeah, right.
I don't know. I kind of want to mention Peter Stormare and then the whole like historic element that they actually introduce in the beginning of the film.
Yeah.
Although it's interspliced with vomiting and frat parties.
Right. Which kind of like the movie could go either way at that point. And I just assumed we were going to go the frat party direction. Yeah. Cause that's always the route I'm just ready to take in a film like this.
You know what I always say about frat boys and gay men?
No. What do you always say about frat boys and gay men?
The difference between a frat boy and a gay boy is a 6-pack of beer.
Yeah, well, I'm not too big on beer, so
neither I'll just have am to... I. All right, nor am I a frat boy or a gay boy.
All right, then.
Yet.
So there's no transition here to go from frat boy to racism, but yeah. let's just
frat
move
boys
right
are
through
all
that.
Racist.
I wanted to talk about blaxploitation a little bit more, and I guess just kind of mention blaxploitation because we've talked about it on the show before. And it always makes me really uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Because there's like this underlying theme of racism.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're fairly young. Like we kind of grew up after the awareness of racism after people kind of like society kind of said, well, this is bad and let's not do this anymore.
Yeah.
So it's always been a joke to me.
Me too.
I've never really had like, well, being a like young white kid in Chicago, like I guess I don't encounter it a whole lot.
Yeah.
But it's never something I've had to deal with on a serious level.
Right.
So it's always like hearing someone who's actually racist just becomes satire to me.
Mm-hmm.
I can't even like, it takes me a second to really go, oh, that person is a bigoted fuck. You know what I mean? Like
they actually believe what they're saying.
Yeah, right. It's just like such a crazy idea. I can't even handle it. We talked a bit before about racism and blaxploitation on another show. And I've since then I've had this fear that we just came off as like blatantly racist just because we were so not.
Well, we touched on it and we're not doing any better because we definitely touched on it on the Jason Fest podcast.
Oh yeah, we did.
Which was just like, oh, Jason kills black people.
Yeah, right.
And now we're going to touch on it in a different, more enlightened fashion where the South kills black people.
Well, and this, I think they treated it really well. Here's a story context where you can treat a theme like racism in a way that you can't, because it's, I don't want to call it a period piece, but it's about modern day. It's a modern day story with, you know, heavy elements of the Civil War in it. And it gives you a really good opportunity to address
this. Civil War era, not necessarily the Civil War.
Yeah. So they have,
I'm having trouble.
Glad we made that distinction.
It just hit me that we're actually taking this film on an intellectual level.
How exciting is that? Have you had one of these conversations about this film yet?
How many times have
you seen this so far?
56. 2001.
2001 times.
Once per maniac.
So there's a couple ideas here that I don't like and need to dispel. One's really obvious and one's an idea that a lot of people, like our friends, do this all the time. And it's something I hear people do constantly.
One is the Chinese food, like false thing that they...
No, neither of them are the Chinese food myth.
Okay.
The myth of Chinese. Which may not be a myth because it's not important. All right. So the point is... The first one is racism and the second one is the South. All right.
All right.
So we have...
Are you going to argue that neither exists?
Yes.
Okay.
Both are total fabrications. That'd be such a great direction to go. So they have the black guy in this film, which in another film, I would feel bad not knowing his name. But in this film, the point is he's the black guy. He's literally the black guy of the entire cast, of the entire ensemble there. They have a couple different black guys who are like servants, I would say.
Yeah.
They take more of a passive role.
The watermelon guy and then the
butcher shop guy.
The butcher shop guy.
Right. And so you have this kind of dynamic with your main black protagonist where you can address a lot of these different issues by putting like a modern person into that context. Yeah. It gives you this great opportunity to kind of create a commentary on things you can only do in fiction. Well, and I feel like this film, it needs to exist for this reason. You know, whoever came up with the concept of this to be able to tackle issues like that in a totally like insane scenario, yeah, because this makes no sense. You can only address it in fiction. Like you can't even have a logical like we're trying to have a serious yeah discussion, but if we couldn't keep going back, I just gave you the premise.
I keep thinking of his eyes popping out of his head. Oh,
is that making it hard for you?
Yeah.
If I gave you this premise of like, let's pretend that it's the modern day, but there's a bunch of crazy people who think it isn't. We couldn't just have a whole serious conversation right about this, and this film allows us to do that.
We could do it.
Well, you and I could, but it takes unique individuals to tackle that. So this other idea is that the South is just blatantly racist and filled with bigots and not clean and squeaky, mm-hmm, like up here in the North where we're all edumacated, right?
Right.
And
there's no racism.
Right.
I'm colorblind.
And I hear a lot of this from people in the North, surprise, surprise, about how like backwards the South is.
Yeah.
And I've been to the South and it's like the North. I mean, mm-hmm, there's more areas where there's nothing.
Yeah.
There's more countryside and yeah less civilization. And I think a lot of these token South things.
Not like, Deliverance.
Yeah. I think a lot of these token Southern ideas come from the fact that people live in kind of reclusion.
Yeah.
And so that exists. But I mean, the cities down there are like the cities up here. Mm-hmm. And I think they address that a bit in the film in that these people think the way they do, they're backwards because they think it's 150 yeah years ago, yeah, not because they're from the South. Yeah. You know, you have these kids who are in the South
yeah
and, you know, they're all just going on spring break and whatever. And
yeah, there's an allusion to that in Peter Stormare's scene where he's like, well, then now those of you who are going down to Florida...
Is this your Peter Stormare?
No, I'm sorry. So there's a part where Peter Stormare says, those of you who are going on spring break down in Florida, you'll understand why the South hates you.
Right.
Essentially, in less eloquent wording. And it's just totally untrue. And it's, well, maybe not totally untrue, but it's like way exaggerated, overblown, sure, not the way that's really... You know,
if we didn't have so many cities or bigger suburbs and communities up here, I think you would find just as much of that.
Oh, sure. Well, it is up here. I mean, it's not like it's doesn't exist up here. There are just as many like backwoods hick towns that'll, sure, you know,
chew go, you
around,
up and eat you.
Go around lynching niggers if they get the chance.
Right. Yeah, absolutely.
But let's not give them that chance. Let's take that chance away and let's talk about Robert England. Someone who doesn't want to lynch a nigger is Robert England. Acclaimed horror actor Robert England.
Who was fantastic.
Wonderful.
I am so excited for Freddy Palooza.
Yeah.
Killapalooza. Oh, what do we call it?
Killapalooza 2.
Freddy-thon. All right. So if you haven't been paying attention, we're doing all the, I almost said the Freddy the 13th movies.
The Freddy the 13th.
We're doing all the.
He's the 13th in a long generational list of Freddys.
We're doing all, we're doing all the Freddy movies.
Freddy.
God damn it. Finish my sentence without giggling for like 5 seconds. We're doing all the Freddy movies. So I'm just dropping that in here. That's mm-hmm your notice. Start watching the Freddy movies.
Yeah, it's coming up in, you know, a few shows.
Yeah. Robert England is fucking incredible in this.
Yeah.
He's wonderful.
I think the only exposition you've had to Robert England before this is Behind the Mask, right?
Right.
Okay. And in Behind the Mask, he's a really like subtle, docile, yeah, downplayed character.
Sure.
This is how Robert England usually is. He's like off the wall, zany, like screaming, dancing, which I hope you kind of get a better idea of why I was so fucking excited to see him.
Yeah.
When he was in the city over at the Music Box.
Yeah, for sure.
And
he was at the Music Box.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that's where he was.
Yeah.
Man, if this could have all just happened months ago, mm-hmm, I missed out. So he's got these one-liners in this film, which I had to talk about. So the film's got a lot of one-liners, which is something that I always kind of take movies to task for. And I just never agree that one-liners are funny.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe it's that kind of breed of comedy that it's just not my thing or whatever.
Yeah.
But the ones he delivers are just, they're pitch perfect every time. Almost to the point where like every time someone else delivered a one-liner, I was just hoping there's like a special feature on the DVD where his head would just pop in over the side of the screen and just deliver the one-liner and just leave. So if you're listening, when you do this on Blu-ray, special feature idea, I'm just saying.
I mean, Robert, and I'm not going to go ahead and normally I'll blah, blah, blah. The cast was so great. This was so good. This is most of this cast was really bad. And I'm going to digress. Most of this cast is really good for their part, not a good actor.
Okay, I can see that.
I mean, the ones that I'm going to pick specifically, I don't even remember his name. The guy that played the gay guy.
Uh-huh.
That's just, he was just being himself.
Right.
If you look at some of the, like, the tryout tapes or whatever, it's like him reading a line and then him talking, and it's the same guy.
Good casting, bad cast.
Yeah. that's the guy, Anderson Lee, he bothers me.
Yeah. Like,
but I think he's supposed to.
Okay.
Which is why I'm okay with it. All of the people that played the Southern, like, you know, the maniacs.
Right.
I love.
Mm-hmm.
No matter how bad of actors they really were. Hucklebilly, for example.
Yeah.
Really not a good actor.
No.
Totally love him in this film.
All right. He makes me uncomfortable.
That's probably about the right feeling.
Yeah.
But now that I've like torn this film apart and I love this film, so I don't want to do that. So now I'm going to talk about the actors in this film who really like own the fucking film.
Sure.
Peter Stormare, who like I love, and that we've noted that in Constantine. He's great in this film. He's got a bit part. He doesn't do anything spectacular, but you know, just mentioning Peter Stormare and Robert Englund, who you've already covered, and I think adequately so. Then the other two, Granny, who is actually, she plays the teacher in Nightmare on Elm Street. She's another, you know, horror like cameo favorite that this film picked up. She's really good in the film. I mean, she's got a really strange, like, gotta be nice, gotta be fucking crazy role.
Yeah.
And she pulls it off.
That's something I was going to credit Robert Englund a lot for, is that he goes from sinister to like ridiculously gleeful.
Yeah.
And like that.
And I mean, you totally buy it.
Yeah. And from, I think that's gotta be something that's hard to do as an actor, you know, because you kind of see in the beginning, you see him, when you see him publicly, it's as a very like excited guy.
Uh-huh.
And then when you see him like the kind of backdoor operation scenes, he's always he's sinister.
Yeah.
And they kind of have to merge that as it becomes apparent what's happening. And he pulls it off perfectly. Mm-hmm. That's something from the beginning of the film. I was like, well, when these two have to merge, I don't know how that's going to go, but it worked.
Yeah. And then also,
no, the correct response is yes, it did.
Yes, it did. Anyway, so the other actor, Kane Hodder was in this film. That's all I'm saying. Not saying not saying who. He's right. In this film. And then also the other actor who I am floored by every time I see him in a film is Giuseppe Andrews. Probably mostly this film, more so than Cabin Fever. He's cute in Cabin Fever. He's funny. He's like, you know, the party cop in Cabin Fever, Winston.
Mm-hmm.
He's hilarious in Cabin Fever, but this film, he like fucking takes the cake.
Sure.
He shows up. He like, there's that scene where like when old Hopper boy comes down on her, she won't know what hit her, and then it's like the blurry scene of him walking in slow motion,
right?
And I think that's gonna bring us right into the wonders of the gore of 2001 Maniacs.
Yeah, for sure.
So this film has some of the most gore in any of the films I own.
Yeah, you told me that going into it and I didn't believe you.
Yeah,
and I was wrong.
There's like 8 brains in this film.
Not a brain.
Everybody gets their heads cut off. A woman gets dismembered by horses.
Right.
Dismemberment
by horses is pretty bold.
Yeah.
So they tie her up to these horses, and I didn't think they were going to do it, but then I remembered last time I said that they're not going to do that. Do you remember what movie that was? I started being tied to horses in my brain and went, they're not going to, I'm like, oh, that's going to happen.
Part of the gore, part of the wonder of this film is going, oh my God, they're actually going to dig it there.
Yeah, for sure.
And for the first time ever, I'm going to digress from spoiling part of this film, because you can spoil just by knowing what they're going to do. But I think you want to talk a little bit more about the horse dismemberment scene with Miss Pussy.
So the way they cut this movie does a lot of really interesting things as far as editing or just cinematic stuff in general. You know, we didn't really touch on it. I wanted to mention it with Robert Englund, but he's got one of those iconic hero shots we talk about with these big horror guys where, you know, in front of the flame.
Yeah, with the sword.
Like jumping in with the sword. Yeah, it's just these great shots, and he just builds that. He makes that so well. But so they have this shot where it's you have your A and B stories running at the same time, which in a very cute way sort of tie into each other, but in a very gimmicky way.
Mm-hmm.
And here that is them chasing the cats and also the chasing of Miss Pussy Cats, which leads to dismemberment by horses.
Yep.
But they use the cat sounds like every time they go back to her or when certain things happen and then they flipped between the two stories. And I really love that. And then they kind of use that device to end that whole little section of film, mm-hmm. that whole little, like, sometimes we talk about how it would be cool if they just use scenes from movies as trailers.
Yeah.
And that was one of those like segmented little kind of scenes that ends in them all eating, which is one of the only times you see cannibalism, like actually in the film, mm-hmm. for a film about cannibals. I found out really unique too. So right after she's ripped apart, they go right into like ripping the meat at dinner. Yeah,
pulling the leg off the turkey.
Which is how you want to end that whole little scene there.
That was really Eli Roth.
Yeah.
That was a really Eli Roth thing to do.
Well, and this would have just been like a normal kind of comical thing, but then that kind of, it becomes one of those things that's probably more amusing the second time you watch it because it turns out they are eating her.
Yeah.
So it's more than just a like a visual thing. Yeah. And they give that hint when one of the characters picks up a big slab of meat and it's got her tattoo on it. Now they kind of drive it home. I wish it were a little more subtle.
You wish they didn't cut back.
They do a quick mini montage. Yeah. Of the scene where they show you the tattoo. Mm-hmm. And I think if it would have been more subtle, it would have been great. But another one of the subtleties they kind of put in is when they have the jars with the dates.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just a kind of quick scene, which almost seems pointless until you get to the ending.
You forget about it.
Yeah. Which is how you want to deal with the subtle scene. You want to kind of forget about it. But it shows that they've been doing this. You know, they don't list dates from every year, but you kind of get the idea that this is like an annual thing.
Well, like one of them's in like 1870.
Sure.
But there's a lot of 1992.
Right. Which becomes really important at the end of the film because they kind of give you this sort of ambiguous ending, like, did it happen? Didn't it? And then, you know, and they fix that problem too. But are they ghosts? Is it a cemetery? What's going on? And it kind of shows you that like they've been doing this over and over from the 1800s, which leads you to believe that this isn't like a group of people all decided they hated modern times and wanted to go off. This instantly, just this one shot of jars with dates somehow tells you that these people are like carried over people. It's like Dharma Initiative style. They were like, they've been doing this since then and they just didn't grow up with society around them. M. Night Shyamalan, please take note. So the ending of this film, let's talk about it a little bit while I brought it up.
Yeah.
I think I'm totally good with, you know how much I'm not into the ghost thing.
Yeah. But, well, yeah, I know. It's really tough. And for some reason, this film affords it, I think. Yeah,
you can get away with it in films if you do it right. And I think this is a good example of that. Even, you know, with or without the jar shot, I think was still a good example of it. I don't like when you're taken for a ride on a film and then they dismiss it as a dream. And we've taught, you know, what did that really well. This is without spoiling it, actually, because it's a weird alternate ending scene thing. You know where I'm going with this?
Yeah.
You think that's okay to drop this in here?
Yeah, I think you're good.
If you go back and listen to The Descent, which if you saw it in theaters, you won't even know what I'm talking about, but they kind of did an alternate take on how to end the film that I think works in a dream sequence.
Yeah.
But if you've gone along with a film for a whole hour and a half and then it's going to tell you it was a dream or ghost or it didn't happen or something weird, like, oh, I can't stand that. But they fixed that, I think, with the barbed wire road scene, which is aesthetically a great kill too, with the slingshot callback from earlier. So I really like the end of the film.
Yeah.
It took me it's one of those endings that you don't know that you really like it and you think about it a little bit and you decide you really like it.
Well, one of the reasons that the ending of the film is possibly one of my favorite things about the film. First off, it's one of the only films ever where the bad guys win.
Yeah.
Like, especially in horror.
I didn't even think about that.
In horror, like, there's always someone that gets away.
Yeah.
And that's how they, like, make the movie. You know, like, the main character got away.
Right.
I like how they just fucking killed him. And then the winners are the people in the South who have been wronged by the North in the past, blah, blah, blah. So,
sure.
And I really like that. But furthermore, the reason I like it more than that, and this is just about the whole film, is I like how the film, like, there's this weird, obscure, like, Southern strange storyline, and they, like, make it gory, and it makes you jump, and the cast is fun, and the film is fun, but, like, more than anything, it, like, somehow carries this message. It's strange, because this film has this kind of integrity that you wouldn't expect to come out of a film like this at all.
Yeah.
it seems to be painting this, like paving this way, like this film is without integrity.
Yeah.
But by the end, you're like, no, this film deserves some kind of merit.
You want to pat the creators on the back, yeah, and you're like, no, it had integrity. Yeah. Really, don't sell yourself short.
And then, so it just makes me excited for October 30th this year when 2001 Maniacs, The Beverly Hillbillies comes out.
Oh God. You know, every time
featuring Tony Todd.
Fuck, every time we do one of these movies, you throw this and you're like, hey, guess what's coming out later this year? We kind of make fun of a lot the fact that you do all these horror movies and I do all these documentaries.
Yeah.
This is only, what, the second documentary we've actually tackled on the show?
I think second, maybe the third.
Because we did Walmart.
Is that the only one?
Yeah, I think, okay, that, I think that was
Walmart,
the only one.
And now this one.
So we're still trying to kind of figure out how to do these.
Yeah.
And all of these documentaries, I mean, documentaries in general tend to be a little controversial, mm-hmm, unless they're historical, and even then. But it occurred to me as we were watching this film, it's very possible that the people listening to this like believe in intelligent design, which is kind of a joke. So I guess if they're going to be like really offended about it, they could just not listen. I mean, I'm trying to think about.
That's how I feel like that always goes.
Well, okay. So that's true. So if you don't want to hear us talk about what a silly idea intelligent design is, or let me say this. If you can't
handle,
if you can't handle
the truth,
if your threshold isn't high enough, if you don't have at least the tolerance of us discussing that in a very biased manner, you're going to miss out on the other smaller details that we want to cover in this.
Right.
And that's fine. Just skip through this and go to the end and then we'll see you next time. I think what I still want to do with these documentaries is cover a little bit of how they fared as films.
Okay.
And not even too much, because documentaries kind of get a pass. I mean, they're usually way lower budget. And, you know, they're
every
just not
once
as
in a while
interesting.
You get
to look
a
at.
Really good one.
For sure, for sure. We were just talking about, you know, the Richard Dawkins, mm-hmm, stuff, which will come up a little bit later, which is always good. But I think they're more interesting to look at from like a philosophical standpoint, or in this case, a theological standpoint. And that's better done in other places. So this is just going to be a weird mix of both, I guess.
We also watched this film has not yet at this point in time quite yet been rated.
Oh, yeah. So, but that's film related. So it fit.
Okay.
You know, because I think about our audience and I think people who come here to listen to stuff about movies,
mm-hmm,
and it's a joke to even think about our audience because we don't have one. But if we did, they would be people who come here to listen to stuff about movies, and why would they, you know, care about, I feel like I'm Trojan horsing an evolution debate,
yeah,
idea in here. But then again,
you're smuggling
like
snakes on a plane.
Why did you do that?
I didn't do anything.
That's so not necessary at all. No, I smuggle my snakes on a train. Thank you very much. I prefer my exploitation film to actually be exploitation film. One thing I should mention though, if you come to this podcast, like it's full of political and religious ideas. Yeah. So
nuggets and landmines.
Right. I don't know why you would suspect anything else from us. I should also say that this is kind of full circle for me because the first podcast I ever listened to was Skepticality. I worked with Derek on, doing a Skepticality theme for Awesome Start. And, you know, I talked to both of those guys a little bit. They did a really cool show, which is actually how I found out about this. They did a really cool show on Flock of Dodos, and mm-hmm, they kind of talked to the director and talked about it a bit. So if you want to hear more about the film, you know, if you've just hunted it down and seen it and were kind of curious, that's definitely, I would recommend that people go find the Skepticality podcast and then listen to those. There's a couple interviews. There's an older one with him, and then there's a newer one kind of talking about the Ben Stein fiasco.
Ugh.
All right. So the first thing, let's just cover the film stuff briefly before I get into
real brief.
Titular line.
Yeah.
New way to cover your titular line.
Yep.
They have it right in the beginning and follow it by a dodo dance sequence.
Dodo dance party.
So that's one way to do it. Just add that to the list of ways we've seen, yep, titular lines. I think documentaries.
I wish they had done that in From Hell.
This movie also had a scare shot. It turns out to be one of the most frightening things ever is a yawning night vision rabbit.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That was pretty scary as hell.
Almost as frightening as 2001 Maniacs. It was
almost
up there. I say you could have cut that scene out and put it in there.
You could have easily thrown that in instead of the penis flytrap.
What?
With the teeth.
Oh, yeah. Oh, with the teeth. Right. Got it. Just to go back to the titular line thing really quick. I think that gets a pass for documentaries.
It's fine.
Like most things do. We'll talk about the point of documentaries more when we deal with a lot of BS Michael Moore stuff.
Mm.
But I love your disgusted sound when I bring
that
up documentaries.
That wasn't a disgusted sound. That was Michael Moore sense as a hamburger sound. Well, first off, I just want to talk about how his mother should have been more in the movie.
Yeah. Muffy Moose.
Muffy Moose is fucking awesome in every way.
Yes.
But furthermore, I think he should have put this movie on hold and released a film about his parents' story.
Really?
Because that was like the most intriguing and interesting and enthralling part of the film for me.
I always find that to be a bit of a fault in documentaries because Mike Wilson does that a little bit too in Michael Moore Hates America. I don't know. I don't like pulling away from the point too much to talk about the filmmaker or the filmmaker's parents, which seems to always be the bigger case. But that just, I don't know, might be my own preference, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that really adds to the film?
I don't know if it necessarily adds to the film.
I mean, shouldn't your film have one kind of solid point as a documentary?
Yeah, well, that's, I mean,
solid
you,
thing
can,
to cover.
You can say it takes away from the film. And I mean, I definitely said that when we were watching it, but that nonetheless, does that make it a less interesting story?
His next movie will have more Muffy Moose in it.
Promise?
So, I do promise. It's about global warming too. You'll enjoy it. No, seriously, as he was talking about, I'm like, you know what I love this film is Michael. So she brings up...
she's a witch.
Yeah.
In the 90s.
And a Buddhist, maybe. Buddhist philosopher. Copy of the Tao of Pooh sitting on my end table over there.
And also have handcuffs and a condom.
So other things to talk about in this film. They talked about the last election a bit, that whole... Who do you want to have a beer with? Which, by the way, too much Chris Matthews in this documentary.
Well, they brought that back for this election.
Yeah, that's absolutely true.
Which is strange. I hope that goes away.
Yeah, right.
You know which president I'd rather have a beer with?
Who?
Whichever president decides not to have a beer with
Excellent.
Me.
Excellent. Agreed.
So that would be Mike Gravel.
Mike Gravel only drinks absinthe.
Oh, is that what it is?
No one will know who Mike Gravel is by the
He'll
time
be
this
dead.
Airs.
And he's been dead the whole time.
How do you feel about the who do you want to have a beer with argument? I mean, like intellectually, it's kind of an insulting argument, right?
But wait, is this to do with evolution or the president?
Let's say the president, first of all. Because the Libertarian Party nominated Bob Barr, which I use this in quotations, the who do you want to have a beer with, because neither of us drink. I said Bob Barr, and I wish this were a video cast because Michael has already fallen asleep.
Sorry.
But no, that's my point, is he's not the he's not the hang out with candidate.
No,
right?
He's not.
He makes you nappy. Now, see, that doesn't bother me at all because I'm like voting for somebody who's
sleepy
gonna,
all the time and you need a president that'll help you out with
I'm
that.
I'm really not sleepy all the time. Look how excited I am right now.
So fucking excited.
We're talking
excited.
About Bob Barr and I'm so excited.
Mm-hmm.
But I want a guy who's going to do a job right and I don't care about the beer thing.
Yeah.
But does that really...
It doesn't... Okay, so... Yeah, I mean, no, I would probably, let's just assume for 35, maybe 40 seconds that this argument was, who would you rather have a cranberry juice with?
Sure.
And then I would pick the opposite for president.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Why is that?
Because I'd be afraid to have a president that was super friendly.
Right.
I'd be afraid that they'd be like, well, I don't want to upset my buddy.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I see.
I'd be the one that would be like, I don't care. I'm your president. I'm not your friend.
Right.
Pal.
Not your friend, guy. So the reason I bring this up, and this sounds like I'm straying from evolution, but the second kind of point, and really it tied into that, is that we have kind of a PR problem on the evolution side, in that we don't really know how to pitch these ideas. You know, the reason people like the sit down and have a cranberry juice thing is because they want someone relatable. There's some part of the human psyche that does that. The fact that the whole scientific community is kind of detached in the way they go into these things kind of creates the problem. There's really no doubt that intelligent design or creationism, they're the same thing, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, come on.
One's got more syllables.
Yeah, that is true. One does have more syllables. A scientific study might lead you to the conclusion of which of those has more syllables. But
they're light bulbs in their heart, not their head. So they'll never find out.
Okay, but that's what I mean, right? Is that the light bulb in the head, which is a metaphor they kind of use in the film, it's part of the problem.
Yeah.
The idea I always kind of come to is that we can't really think about the what's in the heart, what's in the gut thing. You have to think with your head, you know, that's kind of what it's there for. Or for zombies to eat your brains. The reaction you had to that question, the same one I think I would have, is that you don't want the person you're going to sit down and have a drink with.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want someone that you're going to, you know, like I would sit down and have a drink with a presidential candidate. I would sit down and have cranberry juice with Bob Barr because I think that would be an interesting life experience.
Yeah.
But the idea of this is that you don't want the guy next door. You don't want the person to come over and talk to you about this.
I mean, if the question is posed like, who would you rather have a drink with? I'm going to pick the candidate that I like the best.
Right.
Not personality wise, but the candidate that I would vote for because that's the one I'm most interested in.
Sure.
I mean, just purely by like mentality, I'm going to be like, I'm going to pick the most interesting candidate. And I guess, albeit that wouldn't necessarily be the one I would vote for all the time because Reverend Al Sharpton ran last time. I mean, I'm just going to pick the one that interests me most, not necessarily because like I would, you know, then after the drink say, you should come to my barbecue.
Yeah.
I would like to just talk to that person.
In looking at this and going, you know, who would you rather have a drink with? That might be easy for us to go, well, we're not going to vote for the person you'd rather have a drink with. That doesn't make sense. But then looking at this, when you kind of turn the tables and you go, who do you want to be? You want to be the person that Americans want to have a drink with. And I think that changes the answer with this debate.
Right.
Because that's why there is such a cultural divide. You know, I have this feeling that there's like, that science seems a little unrelatable. You know, that was the whole point they made with the film towards the end. And that's, had I done this film, I think that's something I would have focused on more because that was an idea I really liked. You know, that whole poker table idea.
Yeah.
That like which group, you know, they had the 8 scientists sitting around the poker table and it was uncomfortable.
Yeah.
There was a lot of yelling and condescension. And then, you know, you look at all these people they interviewed and while some people wouldn't conduct interviews with them, you had the press hound. She would wink at the camera 20 times, but she wouldn't conduct the interview. And you had the Discovery Institute too, who was not interested in allowing interviews. But the rest of them, I would say, were generally likable people. I mean, would you disagree with that?
No.
They're wrong, but they were easier to have conversations with.
Yeah.
And the fact that you could go into it going like, I'm making a film about evolution and you disagree with me and still have a 3-hour conversation with them.
I mean, and they kind of touched on this later in the film, is that maybe, and I mean, I'm going to come off sounding like horribly biased here, so I hope you don't get like the wrong impression of my beliefs. But maybe the fact that they're wrong makes them easier to talk to.
What do you think about that makes them easier
to talk to? Well, because like they said toward the end, like, you know, these evolutionary scientists are so obsessed with the facts and they just want to make sure that all the facts are straight and easy. And the fact that intelligent design is false means they don't have to worry about getting the facts straight because it's fucking not real.
You think they have more time in their personal life to dedicate to being less socially awkward?
If you and I are trying to like dictate evolution to someone and people will ask us questions and then we'll have to further go into detail and we'll eventually lose them. I mean, honestly, I mean, maybe not you or I because we have limited like, you know,
knowledge of the subject,
subject, but now someone talks to an evolutionary an intelligent design believer, whatever called, Dodo. And they're like, oh, blah, blah, I have a question. And they go, oh, yeah, no, it happened. It just pop. And then
there's a lot more time to be personal when you don't have to explain
you the just
great
go,
details.
You just go, oh, yeah, someone designed that. And then they're like, oh, but what's the science? And they're like, well, because you can't prove that it didn't happen.
Yeah.
Purely scientifically, there's no proof.
Well, and Muffy hits on this great point at the very ending of the film, which I think, you know, I think really brought everything home. Which is she talked about, you know, what she believed. She said before she was spiritual and she goes through these phases, but she talked a lot about Buddhism and he asked her why she believed that. And she says, you know, because it sounds like a good idea.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because I like the idea that you're reincarnated, you get to do stuff again. And I have this conversation with people all the time, but like the idea does not equal right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was talking to somebody about this the other day. It's like that Sam Harris argument of diamond in your backyard.
Yeah.
Thinking you have a diamond buried in your backyard when you don't may give you a personal sense of enlightenment and a little pep in your step. But when it comes time to like cash it in, it's not there.
Yeah.
You know, it's just this, it's this false belief that you just have.
Yeah.
And it's the same thing like she said with Buddhism. However, that can be true. But as the argument itself inherently points out, the truth is not what people find valuable. Mm-hmm. How do you change that? Or how do you work around it?
I'm not really sure that there's...
Is it a matter of spinning evolution to have a catchy slogan? I mean, they kind of flirted with that idea.
I think that needs to be avoided as much as possible. Because, well, once you fall into the like celebritous evolutionary like expelled, once it becomes celebrity and everything, then it's going to lose its credibility to a certain degree. I mean, you're going to have to. Part of the fact of evolution being right is the fact that it's scientifically provable, which makes it difficult to approach.
Yeah.
I think that what they touched on at the end of the film that is actually the case is we just need to make people smarter.
Yeah.
So that it's more approachable, but
sure.
it's not that we're dumbing down the science. Mm-hmm. It's that we're raising the awareness of the population.
So what about culturally? What about in things like we make lots of stuff? All right. So what do we do as a reaction?
Well, I don't know. Like, I mean,
what does art have to say about this?
There's incorporations and this goes for me probably more than it does for you because your projects have a different method for your projects. All sure. my projects, I just blatantly just assume that, you know, I try to make it seem like this thing where, come on, it's common sense.
Right.
I try to paint it as common sense without getting too much into like how or why.
Yeah.
And I don't think it makes it more approachable, but I would argue that it makes it more appealing.
These are kind of the two schools of thought then, right? You've taken this approach where you just put it out there. It's people speaking to people, it's ideas. Mm-hmm. You think intelligent design is dumb and you have this feeling that you should just say that because that's your idea, right? Yeah. And that's one way to take it. I always feel like you should Trojan horse it more. Mm-hmm. I mean, I guess the way you do it is more honest. And I have this weird feeling like I try and be honest and I don't know if that's the best way to do this.
Yeah.
Like I think this film is a good method of doing this, right? Because the film itself tries to practice what it preaches, to continue using lots of religious metaphor here.
Mm-hmm.
The film is really humble about itself. It's not really in your face. It tries to kind of analyze the questions and it does it in a lighthearted enough way that, you know, it's possible that people who believe in intelligent design would watch this. You know, we watched just to go back to the Walmart documentary, it was very anti-capitalistic.
Yeah.
We have friends who are more or less capitalistic and the ones, you know, watching it with capitalistic people, if we were coming from a mentality of trying to convince them that capitalism is bad, it would have been uncomfortable.
Yeah.
If we watch a Richard Dawkins documentary with a bunch of creationists, it's uncomfortable. They're not going to want to see it. But a film like this, we could have watched with any mixed group of company. True. It has more of a mass appeal to it.
But,
and I think that might be a way to go.
We'll see, but I think that the failure in that is that had we watched it, let's say with 50% creationists
right.
and 50% evolutionists, both sides would have walked away going, yep, that was my movie.
You think so?
Oh, yeah.
He makes it pretty clear that he's an evolutionist.
Well, yeah, but just because the filmmaker's an evolutionist doesn't mean that the evidence is presented. Like, the evidence is presented strongly on both sides, and the film doesn't feel like it makes a point.
Well,
except for the very end.
Right.
I think the point the film makes more strongly than intelligent design versus evolution is that the battle's being fought incorrectly.
Yeah.
And that's the point the film makes, not necessarily sure. one's right and the other's not.
Well, so the disadvantage we found then in doing it this way, in doing it the kind of less from the heart, I guess, way and more, I don't want to sound like it's not coming from the heart. When you make anything, it comes from the heart, right? But I think there's something more honest about just saying, just everyone speaking their ideas.
Yeah.
And that's not quite what this is. This is more like a carefully calculated, orchestrated thing, which is what I try and do with my stuff too. I think the problem there is you have to make these compromises of fact being one of them. Every time I watch this film, it always starts out like I feel it's not hard enough hitting on the science and why idea is wrong,
mm-hmm.
you know, which it isn't the point of the film, but you always feel like it should be there. Like what you were just saying,
yeah.
You feel like the creationist should walk away from this going, oh, look at all these facts. I was wrong.
But you don't.
So I don't know. I find this idea really intriguing. And I think it's something we should talk about more as we watch more of these documentaries. Also, don't forget about that skepticality thing. Like people listening to this,
mm-hmm.
You're still curious. We only talked about this film a little bit, but they go into great detail on a lot of different things they talk about on that episode. Next time, got two more films. What are they?
We're going to watch.
Let's do this different. Why don't you just take the thing? Because I always just ask you what the films are. It's very repetitious. I hate it.
So what do you want me to do?
Just.
Hey, so. next time we're going to do. Do you want me to ask you? Or do you want
no,
me to
just take it?
You sure?
This is all very uncomfortable for you, isn't it?
Well, I just didn't
I'm just going to leave this all on the show.
I'm going to
be a
on
wonderful
you.
Outro.
Anyway,
what are the two films next time we're doing, Michael?
Next time we're going to do People versus Larry Flint, which is a true story about, you know, Larry Flint, the Hustler magazine guy.
Fantastic.
With Woody Harrelson and Courtney Love.
Didn't people used to get their pornography from magazines?
Yeah. Now magazines put their pornography on the internet.
Oh.
And then we are going to also do Jesus Camp.
Fantastic. So go see The People versus Larry Flint and see Jesus Camp as well. And then go to the show and, you know, listen
watch
to
more stuff. Fucking film.
Bye.